See, the word jazz, as I'm sure you realize, gets used to mean so many different things. So when you talk to me about jazz, and you know I'm a jazz messenger, it means a certain thing. And jazz, as I know it. Hello, my name is Benny Green, and it's a pleasure to be here in Seoul, Korea. The first pianist who I heard who really drew my interest was Thelonious Monk. And after him, I heard McCoy Tyner. And after him, I heard Cedar Walton. And I think especially those three pianists inspired me to want to try to do this myself. But I have many musical heroes. Those were the first ones.
So was Art Blakey one of your musical heroes too?
Most definitely he is. I heard recordings of the Jazz Messengers as a teenager, and when I saw the band live at the Keystone Corner in San Francisco when I was in my late teens, and I saw the energy that Art was sharing with his pianist, first it was James Williams, and then a few years later it was Donald Brown, I wanted to feel that too. So I got this deep inspiration that I want to be a jazz messenger and I want to play with Art Blakey. So I moved to New York when I was 19 with this aspiration, this goal, and I would go hear the Jazz Messengers as often as I could and bring my little tape recorder and record the shows and practice along. And one thing led to another. I met Art Blakey's pianist at the time, whose name is Johnny O'Neill. He introduced me to Art, and a few months later, Art let me sit in with the band for the first time. That was around January or February of 1983. And Art gave me good encouragement. He said, keep doing what you're doing. I'm gonna need you one day. A few months later, I joined Betty Carter and traveled with her for 4 years. And at that time, after I'd been with her for 4 years, Art Blakey offered me the job with the Jazz Messengers. So, but it was 5 years from the time I moved to New York until I was in the band. Oh, being a messenger means, yeah. Means the world to me because Art Blakey's music and the bright light that he shines reached into my heart, inspired me to want to play with him. And then a few years later, it happened. I was in the band playing with him and feeling the depth of his love that he puts into the drums and that he's given to so many musicians who he's nurtured and cultivated in the Messengers who've gone on to become composers and band leaders themselves. So it feels like it's a privilege and an honor and a kind of a responsibility to be a messenger. For me, if I had to make a choice, I would go with the Messengers. But that's not to say one band is better or worse. It's just a matter of personal chemistry. I'm scared of Miles. I was never scared of Art. I love him too much. And each person who feels like they know Art, they have a relationship with him, they know some things in common, but they also have a very unique relationship with him. Each person, things that he will talk with you about and share with you. But Art Blakey is a very spiritual man, very wise, understanding, insightful. So much to learn from him whenever he's talking. Sometimes he's speaking directly, sometimes he's speaking abstractly. But you know, when you listen with respect and love, there's so much that he has to share. I found him, he was always kind to me, never mean. You're right, that Art Blakey is very tough. But he has the biggest heart. I met Oscar because we were introduced by my friend and teacher and band leader, Ray Brown, who, as you may know, is like a musical brother of Oscar's. So Ray introduced us in 1992, and Oscar and I became friends. He encouraged my playing, and we would talk. Back then, it wasn't emailing, but I would write him letters by hand, and we'd talk on the telephone. And we became better friends. He invited me to his home and taught me, not just at the piano, but life. So he invited me to make this record with him after we'd been friends for a few years. And it was a tremendous honor. Yes, I was with Ray for 4.5 years, which was the longest time I spent in one band.
What kind of person was he, Ray Brown?
Oh, Ray, so beautiful. He loved to laugh. He was just full of life. He loved to laugh, to eat, tell jokes, but he loved nothing more than to play his bass. Sometimes we would have a long travel day, maybe 3 flights and not much sleep, not a chance to eat a good meal. But every time after all this traveling, when he would take the bass out of the case, his face would be transformed, like a very young man, very excited. Every time he touched his bass. So it was very inspirational just to be around someone who'd been playing for so long, but still was hungry, hungry for the music. There was one moment, my dear friend Russell Malone and Christian McBride and I made a couple of records together, 1999 and 2000, and we toured together as a trio. But we had some gigs in the US and Christian was unavailable. Maybe he was playing with Sting then or something. And so I'd already left Ray's trio, but I telephoned Ray Brown and I asked him if he would play these gigs with me and Russell. And Ray laughed and he said, "Are you sure you want an old man on bass?" I said, "No, I want the world's greatest bass player. That's why I called you." And he played the gigs with us. And there was one night we were in Chicago and we played the old song called Gone with the Wind. And Russell and I still talk about it because Ray, he had his eyes closed and this smile on his face. It was like he was in heaven, just playing this song, medium tempo. And Ray had a deep love for these songs, these American popular songs, a deep love. And as you understand, he played them, you know, with Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong and the greatest. So to be on the bandstand with him, playing together, but feeling like rapture for the song. It's hard to put in words, but Russell and I, we felt this from him, and it was a very spiritual thing. I have my favorite musicians and bands and records. I've been listening to all my life some of the same records. If it's Red Garland, I've been listening since I was a teenager and still loving it and still enjoying it. And I never had a sense that I wanted to take this great music and do something else with it. I've more had a sense that I want to be authentic, that I want to go deeper inside of this music I love, which is straight ahead jazz. Swinging, it's got some blues to it. And so this is the music when I'm at home that I like to listen to. Old Blue Note records, you know. So this informs the way I play. I don't have an agenda to try to sound old or to ignore innovations that are occurring. I'm just being my own self and reflecting the music that I love. So these people, you know, Wynton Kelly and Horace Silver and Sonny Clark and these kind of people, they inspire my path. And I'm not looking to change what they did. I'm actually looking to get closer to that feeling that they imparted. See, the word jazz, as I'm sure you realize, gets used to mean so many different things. So when you talk to me about jazz, and you know I'm a jazz messenger, it means a certain thing. And jazz, as I know it, swings. But I do realize that today people use the word jazz to mean all sorts of things, including things that don't necessarily swing. So at the end of the day, I really appreciate Duke Ellington's statement that there's only two kinds of music, good and the other. So sometimes these names can be misleading. But, you know, if I'm talking with a friend and you and I are friends and we're talking about jazz, I'm not using the word loosely. I'm using it to mean a very specific thing. I think that it's natural to swing. I think sometimes when a person has difficulty with swing, or grooving. We don't have to just talk about jazz. It could be, you know, other kind of music, but some kind of groove. I think it's natural to groove, and when people have difficulty with it, maybe it's because they have something mental or psychological that makes them sort of uptight. And if a person can notice what it is that makes you uptight and lose that thing, then I think it's going to be your nature to groove. It only, I think, overthinking or being nervous, that obstructs grooving. But if you're relaxed and happy and love the tempo and love the song, I think it's human nature to relate with it rhythmically. I feel like if a person listens to music that's really swinging or grooving and they're attracted to it, they're drawn to the music, they can get deeper into it. Most musicians I know who are accomplished at some point in their life have played along with records, because you can't write down swing or groove. You can't put it into a code. It's a human thing. But when we play with great records, then we're feeling that spirit and we can connect with it. Perhaps consistency, meaning your level of performance, of expression, that you keep it high no matter what. Maybe sometimes you're not so happy or tired or sad, or maybe not so many people in the audience one night. But no matter what, you have to bring the music. Because even if it's just one person in the audience, if you play a beautiful melody from your heart, doesn't have to be anything virtuosic, but just with sincerity, you can save a person's life. I've had people come up and say that to me before. I heard you tonight and your music makes me want to live. Now, I'm not great, but this is somehow the power of the music. So I think all my band leaders have encouraged me to never underestimate the audience and always bring my utmost of spirit.